All right, let's get this party started then. So welcome to the first of hopefully many Myst retrospectives or streams playing Myst, Riven, Exile, Revelations. Hopefully we make it to End of Ages. I'm Jordan or Raticoon on Twitch. This is sort of my first stream that isn't just off of the cuff on PS4 or something like that. And this is something I've been thinking about doing for a while now. Myst was kind of always a special game to me, very formative in the sense that it kind of got me started on the adventure game genre. And Riven in particular made a huge impact on just sort of the quality I expect from games and sort of widening my horizons on what's possible to sort of experience and enjoy in a game. So ideally, I want to do sort of a stream about Myst and Riven, walking through the game and just kind of talking about not only the game and sort of the history and some random facts and trivia that I know, but also some anecdotes from when I played the game or when I've watched other people play the game. I was kind of obsessed with it at through a period of adolescence. We got a Gateway 2000 PC, I think, when I was in fourth grade, and it came with one of those booklets of CDs that had everything from like Microsoft Works to Encarta. But one of them was the Myst CD, and I think I don't know if it was exactly this CD, but it looks something like this, right? It was just sort of a free-floating disc, and I had no idea what it was. It just said Myst. Okay, I'd never used a Windows PC before. My fourth grade self was pretty excited, and I got around to popping this CD in and realized it was a game. I think I just clicked through and like ended up somewhere on the island and had no idea like what the interface was or anything, and I was just kind of going nuts. I was quickly enamored by it and kind of took to it, and even though I had relatively little gaming time per day back then, I muttered my way through it and beat it, and I'll get into all that as we go. So I do have some props here I kind of want to show off. I think I found this in a Goodwill. It's like a jewel case version of the game, with like all of the art intact and in a pretty good condition, and of course the lovely disc and instruction book and everything. The Sega Saturn version of this game. Shout out to Adelino for lending me or giving me, I'm not sure which, the original PlayStation version of Riven. At some point, I opted for the 10th anniversary DVD release, which is sort of a box set that was a DVD per game. So instead of swapping CDs for Riven and Exile, you got like one DVD. It has really nice art, sort of like in the inset too. I think at the same time, I think it was off CyanWorld's website too. I picked up the PC and Mac version of Myst 4, which I've actually never cracked open. And I think that's sort of my primary motivation for doing a lot of this is as enamored as I was for Myst and then Riven, I kind of cooled off when I played Myst 3, wasn't too hot on it. And then something has kind of kept me from playing 4 or 5 ever since. I don't know if it's fear of it being terrible or fear of me just not liking it, and that most of what I had enjoyed, was nostalgia, and I don't want to figure that out. I don't know, but I think this is sort of my attempt to reacclimate to the series and kind of trudge through 1 and 2 and 3, sharing the memories I have, and then hopefully break right into 4, and stream that, and maybe cut together sort of a best of let's play of that, and then on to 5. Whenever I finished the original, I was looking for any and all things Myst I could sink my teeth into, and turns out there was a novel, and so of course I have the Book of Atris, the original novel, probably the best of the three, but again I was pretty young when I read them, so then of course its sequel, the Book of Tiana, and we'll see that name in the game briefly. Then of course there was a final novel, the Book of Dunny. Can't get this right. I got the hardback version of that. Not really as good. I think I heard it described in a review on YouTube as like a bad Star Trek episode, but it's Myst, so it's one of the three only novels. I think there's a fourth one being worked on, but it's been worked being worked on forever. So, Okay, Myst. It is actually the number one selling PC game in the 20th century. It sold over 10 million copies. It was only surpassed in the early 2000s by The Sims. There are actually four like distinct versions of this game, and unfortunately, I will be playing the most recent. I tried to get the Myst Masterpiece working, but I couldn't quite get it working. The original came out in 93. It was sort of remastered in 2000 as Myst Masterpiece. Essentially the same game, just like I think like slightly higher color palette. I think some of the QuickTime movies were re-rendered. And then in the same year, oddly enough, Real Myst came out, which was sort of a 3D, like a real-time 3D version of the game, whereas the first two versions were just HyperCard 2D renders of 3D models. It didn't run that great. I think it was based on the Quake 3 engine or some variant of it. It was a really cool idea. I mean, I was completely shocked that they were working on something like that. I even remember downloading the demo just to see if my PC could run it. And I mean, it was a stretch. It could barely hit the minimum specs. And then recently, within the last few years, Real Myst Masterpiece Edition came out, the fourth edition, the edition we'll be playing today, which is sort of a port of Real Myst to the Unity engine so that it can run on modern PCs and across platforms and that kind of thing. So at the time Myst was released in 93, it kind of became like the killer app for PCs. It was like the reason people found to latch onto to go out and buy that CD-ROM drive or that sound card. It even went as far as to convince people to get a mouse and to kind of adopt that into their normal workflow or upgrade their computer and get a new version of Windows. I watched a couple of videos and I'll throw, whenever this makes it up on YouTube, I'll throw some links. But there's a lot of good YouTube content out there, especially a GDC retrospective that, I don't know if it's Robin or Rand, one of the Miller brothers that made everything in the game essentially, did about an hour long postmortem. In 2013, and went over like the whole creation of the game, and some of the facts here come from that. Their target for puzzle design was non-arbitrary. There are definitely arbitrary puzzles in this game, but their goal was for non-arbitrary puzzles that could be solved with like observation and common sense. All of Myst was developed with a $265,000 budget. And just a totally weird side note that I came across at the end of the GDC postmortem, Phil Fish, the creator of Fez, actually was just gushing about his love for Myst and how it inspired him, and actually ran up to the stage and had Rand, I think, gave the talk, sign his Book of Atris. So I thought that was kind of serendipitous for today's stream. So. Okay, let's jump right into the game, and I'm not gonna go through every step in the game. I mean, this is more like a let's just talk about how things work and not waste a ton of time on repeating mechanics or anything. Just so we get the lovely atmosphere of the Cyan Worlds opening. It's so silly, but it's such a great opening. So, like I said, we're playing the fourth version of Myst. Unfortunately,
I realized the moment I fell into the fissure that the book would not be destroyed as I had planned. I continued falling into that starry expanse of which I had only a fleeting glimpse.
So awkward.
I've tried to speculate where it might have landed, but I must admit that such conjecture is futile. Still, the questions about whose hands might one day hold my Myst book are unsettling to me. I know my apprehensions might never be allayed, and so I close, realizing that perhaps the ending has not yet been written.
I know the game came before the book, but that whole exposition is actually the last like few paragraphs in the Book of Atris, so. Okay. So, the story, people speculated, like, was there sort of an assumed backstory? How did somebody find the Myst Linking book? but the brothers have been pretty adamant that the intent of this was that it was supposed to be you, the player, and you kind of make up your own backstory. It's that this book, which is a book written with what they later called the art, sort of a magic or technology that this ancient race, the Dunni, used to describe worlds in a book with a language and a certain technique. And when they were done, the book would exhibit a like a portal that, when touched, would literally transport the person to this place. There is sort of a back and forth that happens in the narrative in the books and in later games of like, are you writing worlds, and like, are you a god? Are you creating these worlds and then breathing them in life into them, or are you just sort of describing one of an infinite possibility of worlds and then establishing a connection to like an already existing world? So with that heavy thought, here we are at Myst. So I guess the story is supposed to be that somebody somewhere in the real world, on Earth or something, found this book and touched the image and ended up here, and it's just kind of up to the person to figure out. The real-time 3D version is beautiful, but navigation in it is a bit clunky. That's my only real big drawback of this, is that even if you know what you need to do and you know what button you need to push and you know exactly where you want to get, sometimes it can be really clunky, so forgive that. So we're going to go around the island real quick and turn on all these marker switches. You'll see why in a minute. They actually highlight these objects on a map in the library. And we need that because that's how you discover their secrets. Now, I'm not going to go through and do that everywhere. They actually did not originally have this piece of paper dropped on the ground, but they, after they did some original playtesting, which they actually did by pairing two people up and having them kind of talk about the game as they played, and the two brothers would stand behind them taking notes on kind of their reactions or non-reactions. And one of the changes they made was to kind of add an inciting incident, and Atris, the writer of this letter, was actually added, you know, a bit far into development to make sure there was kind of a reason that the player was pushing forward on their quest to explore these worlds and not just kind of doing it on their own volition. So if you didn't read this real quick, even though it was on the screen for a minute, you need to enter the number of marker switches on the island into the imager. It's 8, if I remember correctly, but I still want to go ahead and flip them all on for a few reasons. So we'll run around the island real quick and do that. It's a giant rocket ship. Unfortunately, never actually get to fly in it. Sort of. Yeah, it's really something even now to see this game in full 3D running so brilliantly. But it's also kind of funny that even just a 2D HyperCard game could get as close to sort of eliciting the same emotions of place and the sense of space. The soundtrack is really understated and not present all the time. I'm gonna go ahead and put this combination in. Just don't worry about that. I'm gonna swing it there. Hacks! I think that's the last marker. I'm gonna go ahead and get this going. Going on? Don't worry. You'll find out. Okay, I think all the markers are on. These markers are just sort of denoting the different sections and places on this island. Once we go into the library, you see there's a bunch of books, but they're all burned. Very few of them are readable. But if you do read them, you get a lot of backstory about each of the four ages that you can go to. and some clues about how to solve some of these puzzles to get to the ages themselves. So basically, to get to any of these four ages, you need a combination of information from the tower and from these books, and you put all that information together and you can solve these puzzles. The way you get that information is you go over to this map and you hold down this tower until it stops on something like the rocket. You hear this tower rotation sound. And, oh, what's that? As a kid, I was dumb and kind of, I guess, patient, and I didn't know you could hold down the mouse on this button. So I just clicked, and it would move like a couple pixels, and then I'd hear the tower rotate, and the game would all freeze up because it was like that HyperCard implementation. And I would just sit here for like 5 minutes and just, you know, every 30 seconds click a little bit more until the red line showed up on one of the other objects. I guess it's worth showing there's only four red lines, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. Four ages. Four different ways to find that out. We'll go through it once so you can see. There's also two books here. I'm going to go with Cirrus. But if you open one of them, you just get static. It. Now if you pick up one of these pages, wow, it even tells you to put it in the book. Okay, cool. You notice that the static disappears a little bit. I'll let you listen to this for a second.
Why? Bring me a red page.
Pretty much can't hear anything except bring me a red page. And that's what we'll be doing in every one of the ages. We need four more. We're not going to mess with the blue book because he's crazy, but that's Akinar. That's the other brother. You have a painting of an open door and a painting of a closed door. So since the door's open, we want to close it. Ah, secret passage. I remember we pointed the tower toward the rocket. So when we go back here, we're going to get in this fancy, terrifying looking elevator. And go up. After we shut the door, like smart boys. This is quite an elevator. Now we're on the tower. So there's two sides to the tower. One lets you see, hey look, it's that rocket that we pointed it at. Okay, cool. But the most critical part, oh ho ho. I guess I zoomed in. No, I jumped down. Okay, cool. Right. Is 59 volts. So that's kind of how this works. You turn the marker on, you point the tower at it, and you get a clue. And then you combine that clue with some more information that you get from books in the burned bookshelf, and you can solve these puzzles. I'm gonna be smart this time. Here. Okay. So, we're gonna go in the order that I went in my adolescence. Which is Selenitic, Stoneship, Channelwood, and then Mechanical Age. And boy, did I get stuck in the Mechanical Age. But we'll get there. So, real quick, if you point the tower at the rocket, you get 59 volts on the plaque. If you point it at the gears, you get the time of 2 minutes and or 2 hours and 40 minutes, which is how you get to the clock tower. And then 221, which is the combination you put in the clock tower. If you point it at the ship, you get 3 dates. Remember that. It's not really important, but you get 3 full month, day, and years. And then if you point it at the tree, I think you get the combination 724. Cool. Okay. So, we can go ahead and open 3 of those. So if you, let's talk about the dates. If you get the dates, then you go into the dentist's office or the observatory or whatever, and you'd sit in the chair, which is so cumbersome to do in Real Mist. I would like my appointment, please. Thank you. And you would pull this thing down, type your date in, and you'd get a constellation. When you type those three dates in, you're going to get three constellations that correspond to images in the book. And those images are a snake, a spider, and a leaf. And then the boat rises, and now you have access to the Sunship Age. So now we have access to the Mechanical Age by that gear, and the Stoneship Age by that boat. So we get the second and fourth age. You can't really unlock Channelwood until you're ready to go there, but I guess we can get like halfway there. So we can go in here, and there's a safe, and that's where 724 goes. And you get some matches, and well, great, we don't need matches. Okay, cool. So 59 volts, huh? Well, let's go down here to the generators, and let's get 59 volts out of these generators. Okay. If you get more than 59 volts, it'll trip the breaker, and then you've got to go find the breaker reset switches on the power lines. There's two of them. Only one of them will work. It's kind of a pain. One of them is back there, up that ladder. The other one is up that ladder. But we didn't need that. We're smart. We went right to 59. Yay. Let's open this. Well, now the electricity has allowed us to open the door. And what you'd normally do is go over here, and in the book for the Selenitic Age, it would show five keys you'd play on the keyboard in a sequence. And then you'd come over here and try to match that tone. I did it right before this official stream, but let's see if I can do it off the top of my head just based on the tones that I remember. All right. This is going to be a little annoying. Just sit with me. Okay, I just kind of put it relatively where I want to be. Let's see. Great. Okay, that's not right, but it sounds right to me, so now we get to find out why. Okay, I'm gonna give this a couple more minutes. I'm just gonna reset everything. Of course, on the official stream. I don't do it on the first try. I have proof. I'll cut together the other clip. Although I guess that was before we had audio working, so maybe not the best. I don't know what I did wrong the first time, but so now we've completely unlocked three of the ages, and you know that's kind of the island. That's the point. This is the hub. Rand in his GDC postmortem actually described it as taking inspiration from Disneyland or Disney World, where there's kind of the main street in the middle, and all of the Adventureland and Tomorrowland and everything are all kind of spokes off of that hub. And these four ages are the spokes. The weird thing about Mist, though, is despite describing it that way, once you commit to an age, you can't really just go back until you solve the puzzles on how to get back. But hopefully we won't have a problem with that. So let's go. Age number one, Selenitic Age. So what is the lore for this world? So Atreus wrote this age. Maybe, I'm not sure if he wrote all these or not, but he got to this age, and it's the only world that was uninhabited throughout the lore. I think it's supposed to be a world that with a very, very thin crust and magma just below the surface. We want to get in here to get out of here. So let's just go ahead and like solve the puzzle of the game. Okay, well, so now how did you actually have to solve that? What you'd do is you'd explore. I mean, that's kind of the point of the game. And you'd see that there are these different areas on the age. There's the chasm, which, you know, I don't think they did a great job interpreting magma or lava with a red water texture, but it actually looked better in the HyperCard version, I think. You see these microphones and these little buttons. Now, I think these are emitting... maybe they're speakers. They're emitting a signal now. That's the sound of this roar from the depths. We're going to activate like five of those. We're going to go over to the water. I swear, this age just doesn't quite capture the feel of how serene it felt in the can-rendered versions, but... turn that on. There's a blue page. We don't want the blue page. We want the red pages. So that's kind of the loop of these worlds, right? Go to the world, figure out how to get back to Mist Island, and grab a page while you're there. And then that's how you kind of advance the progression of hearing more of the brothers' stories from the prison books that they are in. So what is their deal? There's the red page we want. You see my cursor just is literally holding a red page. If you try to go grab the blue page, you can't. It will just... well, you can, but it'll swap with the red. It doesn't really make a ton of sense that you can only take one page back with you, but that's kind of how the game mechanic works. You're going to go all the way over to this wind button. Oh, that's right. There are bats in the 3D version. Weird. There's this destroyed dock, and we're going to go down the spooky hole. And flip the lights. A bit Resident Evil down here. So yeah, we would make it all the way over here, and there's this nice little contraption that you open, and you kind of align toward the sound you're looking for. So we're looking for the water sound. That's the clock. I'm gonna do one of these just so we know how it works, but I'm not gonna sit here and do all of it. There we go. So anyway, you do this for all five of them, and kind of hit the sun button. I think that's it. Yeah, and you get this sequence, and if you've aligned all of them correctly and turned all of them on, you get the sequence that we got for the door back at the front of the age. I'm gonna turn the lights off. Oh no! I'm terrified. I will say, though, that... you know, as a kid with a computer by himself, not really knowing like what this game was going to unfold into, the atmospheric soundtrack and sound effects and kind of like for the time photorealistic graphics, it was a pretty spooky game. You know, you weren't quite sure like what to expect around any corner. So anyway, so you put them in the sequence. It's got a lot of fake sounds in there, so it's not even just five sounds you have to sequence, but there's like 10 or so. But if you do them in the right order, you get this door unlocked. Did it lock again? Yay. Okay. So this is the puzzle that everyone hates. In the postmortem, Rand or Robin, whichever one it was that I can't remember, said it's the one he hates the most and is the most arbitrary and violates all the rules they set out when they went to design these puzzles. But then in an interview with the AV Club a few years ago, also said that it's secretly the one he likes the most because it is, like, very elegant. It's just that most people missed the actual point. So you're in this little bathysphere, and we're going down into the depths of the caves in this thin-crusted world. Don't ask me how Atrus was able to, like, construct all of this, but, you know, he did. I believe him. So now we just have to navigate this, like, underground maze. So luckily, it's pretty straightforward how to solve this puzzle, but I will admit, as a kid, I did not know how it was signposting how to navigate, and I mapped the entire thing out, and I think I, like, brute-forced my way to the ending. So what's actually happened here is that noise teaches you pretty quickly the only way to go forward is north, and you hear that sound, and then the only way to go forward is west, and you hear a different sound, and you just kind of have to start associating certain sounds with the direction. So now we hear that sound again, we go north again, next we hear east, and then they start layering. Sometimes it'll go southeast or northeast, and you hear both sounds. Airbrake. Despite being kind of slow and repetitive, I promise you the original version was much slower and much more repetitive because it had to load Anchor Time Video every time you press one of those buttons. Oh, okay, so we want to go east again. Just for the sake of a good stream, I definitely have a map of this open, but it's still relatively straightforward following the sounds. A thunk is south, so we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more stops to make. So south again. I think now we're getting southeast, so you'll hear like a layered sound. No sound, then you backtrack. There you go. You could just turn 180 and go forward, but sure. A trill. So it's not north. audio is still good, game audio, mic balance still good, I'm dropping shit, just to let you know that I'm not making the worst sounding stuff ever. It's a northwest. Yeah. The nice ping from north. Yay, sounds good. Oh, there's the air brake for east, so I think we're going northeast. I see Lokai Husky is having fun with the emotes on his first time in this chat. I think this is one of the easier worlds. There's not really much of a puzzle to solve here, other than the maze, which can be brute forced. It's probably a good thing I did it first. There's that air brake. Ha! I've solved your riddle, Mist. One age down. This lovely mechanical sound. I went the wrong way. Quote lava. But there's our trip back to Mist. That is the ceiling of the library, which it took me a while to figure out as a kid. I wasn't quite sure what I was looking at. I hope we don't start spamming. Okay. So we've got the red page, so we drop it in the red book. And now we can see we have a different message.
Return.
Yes, I have, buddy.
Thank you for bringing me red page.
You're very welcome.
You must continue to help.
I must. I am completely and utterly compelled to help you. On to Stone Ship, which we've already unlocked. This was the demo for Real Mist, I think I mentioned earlier. Barely worked on my computer. I think it's kind of one of the things I use as an example of why we needed a new one. Need is a really strong word there. As we watch this intro to Stone Ship, which is much darker and stormier and atmospheric than the HyperCard version, I want to read a quick quote from an AV Club interview that the Millers gave about that Maze Runner puzzle. He says, "I know that it was a hated part of Mist, but frankly, I loved it. There was a certain elegance to that puzzle that I think people don't understand. I love the fact that people play through an entire world that has everything to do with sound, and then they go down to this vehicle at the bottom of the world, and they forget about it. And we're still giving them sound clues for what to do every time they turn. Now, I think the sound clues could have been louder, and that's what we didn't do well. I think they could have been a little more prevalent, but I love it. The maze is actually laid out along with the sounds so that it elegantly reveals itself. There's no chance of confusion. If you're listening to the sounds from the very beginning, you will learn the maze. That's one of my evil, passionate puzzles because I really thought that one was done well, and people who hate it are just plain wrong." So there you go, haters. So Stone Ship, the lore of Stone Ship is that I think there were two boys that were kind of adrift in this world. They found a third. They didn't know anything about civilization, but they banded together to kind of survive on this treacherous, stormy ocean, as far as you can see, world. Atris kind of linked to the world through one of his books and found the three of them and taught them about civilization and they became friends, and Atris then tried to change the book so that there was a ship in the world so they could sail and meet other people. And unfortunately, it kind of just morphed into the world. And this is what the result was. So not quite as planned, but before Atrus left, he helped them build a lighthouse, which was used to attract others in the area. They all met up. They founded sort of a society, and then of course his son showed up and I think wrecked the place, and that's kind of the state it's in now. That's kind of the central theme of this story, is Atrus was a good guy who wrote all this stuff, and his son started out as good people too, but became kind of psychopathic and wanted to rule over all the indigenous people of every world they found in their quest for power. And eventually Atrus decided they needed to be trapped in books. Right before that that trap was sprung, the boys trapped Atrus in the real world, in the underground world of Dunny. And so they kind of trapped each other at the same time, and the world just became a stalemate until you showed up, and now you can help all of them if you choose. So what we're doing in this world is, just like every other world, trying to get back to the mist. I used a pump to pump the water out of the lighthouse here. We're going to go to the bottom and find a treasure chest. This is a relatively simple puzzle. I don't think it took me too long as a kid to figure out what to do, but I'm not sure I really rocked the concept of the puzzle. So it's full of water. You let it out, and then you close the valve. So now it's airtight, but full of air. We're going to go let the water back in, if I can figure out how to navigate up. One of the most odd UI navigation aspects of this 3D, real-time 3D version is just climbing up these stairs. Luckily, there's a run button. So we're going to go ahead and hit the second pump here, which is going to unpump the cave in this rock structure. That's where we're going next. And as we can see, when the water fills back up here, there's the treasure chest and this key on a chain. And what do you know? Inside is another key, which we use here. All right. We've solved the riddle. And what's up here but a generator and the 2007 Tesla? The batteries. We get to do this really cool mini game where we just sit here and charge these batteries. I guess at least we can thank the literal makers for not having to crank this thing as long as it would have taken to actually charge these batteries. But okay, batteries are charged. The light on the lighthouse is now active. If you were to go back up to the precipice up here and look through the telescope, when you centered it over the light on the lighthouse, it would be at the position of 135 degrees. Keep that in mind. We're gonna go down to the bottom. We're gonna find Cirrus and Akinar's room. Those are the names of the two boys trapped. You know, we're gonna go ahead and open that. That was kind of a lot more hidden in the HyperCard version. This is the lavish, extravagant Cirrus's room. The nativist other room is Akinar's, and they're always kind of styled in that way. There's our red page. That's all we really need. You can play with some stuff here. Take a nap. You know, you're kind of freaked out. You're using magic to jump between worlds. Maybe you do need a nap. You can press this ball and have it do this whoosh thing. Not freaked out at all, yeah. Good to go. I'm going to skip back in our room, but it's a creepy, you know, tribal mask, torture chamber kind of aesthetic. But while we still have power going to the lighthouse, and we can see, let's go ahead and solve this puzzle. So I believe the 135 corresponds to the degrees around clockwise, right? So 90 would be here, 180 would be here, and 135 is kind of right in between. So this button activates the lights in the underground ship. Any other button will kill the power feed from the lighthouse, and you'll have to kind of go back up and crank the batteries and start over. Again, as a kid, not sure I quite understood. I think I didn't quite know, like, where to start from zero. I think I got the concept of it being 135 degrees, and just didn't know from where. Oh, here's Sirius's room. Oh, you know, there's actually something rather important in this area. I just gotta figure out which drawer it's in. Ah, there you go. Take a quick look at that. You're gonna find another half of it in Channelwood. And we'll talk about that later. This is the creepy dude's room, and there's the blue page. We're gonna run as fast as we can. Okay. Something about being able to move freely through this kind of a space is just way less creepy than feeling confined to just a number of clicks. Okay, so now we gotta pump the third pump to get the water out of the ship. And there we go. Down into the failed experiment lasers. And for whatever reason, the mist book is... I think the precursor to that technology was that sphere thing in Sirius' room, but... Alright, two ages down. I don't know how long Channelwood's gonna take. I feel like it's kind of a brute force-y puzzle world, but let's see what Sirius has to say. Three ages.
Have returned.
I said that last time.
Additional page. Leave my prison on this forgotten island of...
The acting is so hammy, but it's just amazing. It's such an amazing part of this game. Okay. Wah! So now we're doing Channelwood, which we haven't actually unlocked yet, because you kind of got to unlock it all in one step. So remember those matches we opened? Yeah. Well, we need to light this this burner here. We're gonna open it. Strike. You actually have to strike the match. That even works in the HyperCard version. There, we lit the furnace. Now we're gonna turn on the fuel, and it's gonna go nuts. We hear the sound, and what's that? Ah, it's a tree. Well, if you get in that, you can take a ride to the top, and you can get a really cool view of Mist Island, and not much else. So, let's turn it off, because that doesn't really help us. Wow, I'm sorry, the navigation is just nuts. You can also turn this off about 1,000 times faster than you could in the original. And yes, my, like, 12-year-old self felt so smart when I realized, oh, you could just get in it and then it goes down and I bet, yeah, there's a world underneath. Ah, I figured it out. And yes, you can go back by turning the furnace on from underground. So here we go, Channelwood. The lore of this world, I have some notes here, but like it's sort of there were like surface dwellers when there was land and tree dwellers, and the world was sinking, and somehow the surface dwellers sacrificed themselves to save the world, and the tree dwellers never forgot them and revered that race as like gods. There was one survivor that they kind of kept as their king or their deity. When Atrus showed up, he looked a lot like the humanoid creatures of the surface, so he was also revered as a god. He communed with them and learned about their culture. I think the original humanoid died at one point and they cremated him, but then Atrus brought his sons and everybody loved each other and it was great, and then Atreus went away, and eventually his sons did experiments on them and wiped them out or something, and now, of course, just like every other world, the sons were evil, and now there's no more life on the age, so another strike against the sons. So first we gotta get water flowing through this pipe so we can get some hydro power. So this windmill we're under is pulling water out of the sea. So we just have to turn the valve on. And I can't tell you how many times I walked past this as a kid and did not realize it was there, did not see it. It's definitely a kind of a weird example of the pixel hunting in early adventure games, but also strangely realistic. If you want water to flow through, you gotta turn it on. And now you hear it anywhere you walk, which is just an essential audio cue, and it sounds awesome. So we're trying to get up to the second level up there, so that then we can get up to the third level. Okay, so that opens from the back, I believe. Let's see. This is one of those awesome navigation problems with Real Mist. Okay. Haven't done this world in a while, so I can't quite remember if the door locks. I'm pretty sure it unlocks from the back, and then this path actually powers it for the third level. I'm probably just rambling and not making much sense, but stick with me. I haven't steered you wrong yet. The real-time lighting and water effects really do shine in this world. It was pretty stagnant feeling when nothing moved in the HyperCard version. Okay. So, neat. We got power, the water, flowing to a generator that's converting to power, so we can get in this elevator, shut the door this time, and ride out. So we're actually only on the second level. That doesn't help us much, because neither of the pages are on the second level, I believe. I think we actually have to get power running to the third level, and that's where the pages are. Even if they aren't on the third level, the third level is definitely worth seeing. I think this was my favorite age as a kid, just because it was, it's like the kid's dream of the treehouse and scaling up, and, you know, I like the springs and the water from growing up in Florida, and it was kind of a green world. It was really cool. It was also, like, a bit difficult to wrap your head around, like, all the different nodes you could travel to in this world. The real-time 3D version definitely helps you visualize kind of what's going on here. So first, yeah, you have to know to go to this door, or this little hut, and open that door, and I always thought that was kind of a weird, contrived thing, because it's just not obvious that that's the way to solve that that impediment. But we did. And even at a run speed, we're still taking our time. This is also literally terrifying. Like, you don't know who built this. You don't know how long this has been here, or how many storms have come through here. And I don't think you're confidently striding around this world. I mean, who's gonna go down that? That's like a death trap. Okay, so we need to get power running to this second to third floor elevator, which is what we did earlier. Okay. The dreaded 3D going down a spiral staircase strikes again. Boy, if you aren't sick. Okay. Gonna go flip this switch and get power to that third elevator and see one of the coolest areas of Myst, and also just the most effed up, creepy, the suns are definitely evil evidence that you'll get in the game. As lame as reading is, I do encourage you, if you ever play this game, to actually take the time to read the lore in the books in the, like, burned bookcase in the library. It's pretty interesting stuff to, like, fill in. We're trying to fill in, like, an actual lore for each one of these worlds, even though It's just window dressing. Okay. So we can actually turn around here. Sneaky, sneaky. We can go into Cirrus's lavish bedroom. Look at that door. And the music rears its head, and oh, it's just so good. And there's our red page. These soundtracks are on Spotify, so if they get stuck in your head or you want to hear more, I guess they're also on Apple Music. Robin Miller is definitely the composer of the soundtracks for Mr. Ribbon, so it stands to reason that Rand is probably the one that came up with some work. Hey, check this out. You know, if this was my world and I just built tree houses and I saw a floating head, I'd probably think they were gods too. So, but sneaky, sneaky, it's actually an imager that's being run out of this little hut over here that is actually Akinar's room. The brutalist who sleeps on wood slats. There's the blue page, and this is the actual, like, data for the imager that's showing those movies. So it's set to number one right now. You can kind of see. But you can also see some alternate that they might have shown otherwise. Oh, but the fourth one is just the absolute best.
I hope I pushed the right button. Very interesting device. I'm not erasing anything important, am I? He is preparing. Remember, take only one page.
Just an awesome little piece of lore. It's like a message Cirrus tried to leave for Akinar as they were scheming to trap Atrus, their father, in Dunny. Little did they know he was also planning to trap them. One page, what did that mean? Well, the one thing I forgot to pull out of this drawer in here, I hope it's in here so I can at least show you. Is the other half of that note. Ah, okay. If you put those together, which I did as a kid, I was so excited to write those down and put them together and see what they said. They tell you that you can access something rather secret if you turn all of the marker switches on this island to the on position and then go back to the one dock and pull it down to the off, which we will do after we finish the mechanical age. Okay. We're gonna take this shortcut. We just gotta get back to Mist now, right? We got our page. We're good to go. We need to return. You know, as dangerous as this looks, it looks pretty much like the dock we had going through the swamp growing up at my parents' house, so it's oddly familiar if terrifying. Okay, so it doesn't matter which way this goes, right? Right, so we need it to go this way first, which it already is. Yep. Power this little generator to lift us a walkway. I don't know why that's there or how that works, but I'm a smart boy because I solved it. We also need to connect this pipe while the water's off. But we're not going to be able to get power over here. Okay, cool. This is the run speed. If I take off shift, we walk about this fast. Yeah, no. I don't even want to think about how many days and hours I sunk into solving these puzzles originally, but again, I was pretty young, and every second I played of this game was a joy, whether or not I was solving anything or not. However, I don't think I spent a ton of time solving these worlds, because a lot of them can be brute-forced with enough effort and enough free time that you have when you do all your homework at school before you come home for the day, right? But the next stage, we're gonna have to talk about that one, because I think I got stuck there for a few months, and the lengths to which I tried to brute-force that age gave me a sort of complex about finishing this game that probably explains why I became so obsessed with it. But we're just a few short minutes away from seeing it. So let's head back to Myst. Give Cirrus his fourth page, if you count the one that was sitting next to the book. Okay, where is he at? Have we returned?
With each page I can see more clearly.
Ah, okay.
Soon, free from this horrible prison, this book. You must visit the one remaining age you have not.
Got it, okay. I was way ahead of you, to be totally honest. So bright outside now. It's like the real Florida. Okay, since we've already opened the gears, we're just gonna jump right into the last age, the mechanical age. The bane of my young existence. I see we found the raccoon. Okay, so let's talk about the mechanical age. What's the lore of this world? Well, there's a lot of gears everywhere. But before this thing existed, there was a small community built on these islands when they were less covered in water. There was like a prophecy or sort of a mythos in the world back then that these ships on black sails would come through and decimate everyone, so they had like defenses built up sort of in that direction. They did come through, and they wiped out everybody, and there were only a few survivors. I think Atris linked to this world after that event. When it was about to happen again, it's supposed to happen like every 100 years, and they kind of banded together and tried to survive, but they were pretty sure they were not going to survive when they came through again. So Atris helped them and stopped them, and like they built defenses, and I think it was this structure that they built to ward off the black sailed ships, and eventually they left and they gave up their attack. But of course, just like all the other worlds, as soon as Atris left and left his sons in charge, they began to experiment and torture and I believe killed all of the survivors. And this is kind of what's left of the world after those events. You'll see in here they've carved out like each side of this fortress as one of their rooms, just like the other worlds. A little fun piece of trivia, this central structure was modeled after a sketch that one of the Miller brothers had done for a D&D campaign when they were children. So because that was like an inspiration for them, they pulled those sketches out and sort of left a bit of that inspiration in the actual game. So let's talk about this world. To get back to Mist, you have to solve this puzzle. These drop to stairs. The Mist book is in here. So, you know, why not? Since I spent so much time as a kid. Let's go ahead and take care of that. Oh boy. Okay, how do you actually solve this? Well, you can see this thing's on a track. There's an island to the east, and there's another island to the north of this. And that little plaque up here that you can see on the island has half of these symbols, and the other has the other half. So you gotta figure out how to get to those islands. Of course, you don't know that when you get dropped in the world, but that's what you gotta do. Pretty straightforward. How did my young self spend months exploring every freaking inch and pixel of this world without being able to solve it? Well, let's take a look inside. And this, strangely, as many times as I looked over the screens of the HyperCard version of this game, the 3D version of this looks just dead on accurate. It's disturbing how much PTSD I'm getting from that experience, just looking at these models. It's a bit more obvious that there's a panel here. I think it's a little less obvious in the original version. But each of these rooms has like a secret panel where you can kind of go in and see that, you know, they're pretty messed up. They're making poisons, and there's, I think, a head or a dead body or something in this crate. Yeah, cool. This is obviously Akinar's area, and you got a nice electrified cage here. Yay. And yeah, don't cross this guy, I guess. You know, but sure, free him from his book. Come back here in a second. That machine's kind of important. So, we gotta get this elevator working. So, this is pretty straightforward and was solved, like, within seconds as a kid. Yeah, go down here, and... That's it. It's not a puzzle. I don't get it, but okay. And you put the stairs up, and you have access to the elevator. Yeah, let's save that for a second. Let's go get our red page. So this is Akinar's room. A lavish, exquisite quarter of this. You can make the bird do things like this. There's a chess set. I can sit because I'm the king. And you can do this. Make shapes glow and stop glowing, and then you can look through a telescope and see nothing. Cool. Oh yeah, and there's a secret panel here, which is actually about as hidden as it was in the original in this version. So let's go in here. And now you've got an obsession with wealth and rare things. You've got a nice story building note here where the brothers are at each other's throats. Because of their greed and lust for power. So this is a note from Akinar to Cirrus in his secret room. But we want the red page, so let's grab that and get out of here. So, what's the mystery of this this world? Well, let's go back to those controls I pointed out earlier. These I found with pretty relative ease as a kid, and I totally understood it. It literally says it's a rotation simulator. So we'll let it boot up here. We want to engage it. This is kind of the, like, on-off switch. And we're going to move it. And let go. And we get an air brake. And then we move it to the north. And we get a sound. Does this sound familiar? What do you think this sound's gonna be? Ah, a trill. I bet this is gonna be a clunk. Actually, could be wrong about that. I don't remember. Yeah. Okay. So, this is how you rotate the tower, but this is just a simulator. How do you rotate the tower for real? Well, the only place we haven't gone yet is the elevator. And whether you believe me or not, I'm going to explain to you how this worked in my head as a kid. You go to the top of this elevator. You go out, and there is nothing. Nothing. Some gears, and that's it. You go back in the elevator, you press down, and you go down. And that's it. And there's no discernible way to do anything else in this age. I want to describe to you the lengths to which I went pixel hunting on every screen, trying to figure out, did the bird in Sirius's room do something? Did the rotation simulator actually do something? Did the weird gems that turn colors mean something? Then I figured out this was a button. But it stops you in the middle between the two floors for no reason. Now, one thing that is critical that is missing from this version is when you travel from the first to the second floor in this elevator, you pass by a concrete column that is like cut out probably just for the elevator to fit, and they're scoring in very like intentional looking strokes on the concrete. And they sort of looked like the symbols that you could cycle through on the little device out by the beginning where you warp in. So that's where you end up. You stop halfway through when you click that middle button. And it had to mean something. It had to point me to the right answer. Of course it doesn't, but I spent days, weeks, months exploring. Eventually, pixel hunting, I found that you can barely make out some kind of thing up there, right? And it looks, upon inspection, like the controls for the actual rotator, the simulator, right? So this is probably, it makes sense, because there's nothing else you can do up here, so you've got to be able to get up there somehow. So of course, in the HyperCard version, I'm clicking around, you can't do anything. I eventually realized that when you get in the elevator, this happens. Which, at this point, is spooking me out so much as a kid. And it's like the game is getting under my skin and messing with me and trying to get me to go even further down the conspiracy theory hole. Look, I won't waste any more of your time. What you actually have to do is go to the top. And then realize that when you click the middle button, you can still walk out. And then the elevator drops, and voila, you have your controls. And this time you don't have a display, and you have to use the sounds that you've learned either with the simulator or in the Solenitic Age, it's the same sounds, to kind of move the controls and play it by ear to make it to the east and north islands. The west doesn't lead you anywhere. And you get the symbols, and you're good to go. Now, how do you get back down? Oh, there's a button here that recalls the elevators. Now see, as a kid, and as I was stuck and racking my brain about what to do, I kept repeating the mantra over and over, like, just do what you would. This is supposed to be common sense. These puzzles are supposed to be obvious. Well, no person would ever step out of an elevator with the chance that they might be trapped on the second floor. So I thought, I mean, the thought never crossed my mind that that was even a possibility that you could perform, and especially in the original HyperCard version when you couldn't move. You know, I assumed that whenever I clicked that button, it initiated like a QuickTime movie sequence, which in every other piece of the game means you can't click and you can't move, and that your clicks are buffered, so it's going to mess up and click like crazy if you click before the movie's done. So I waited patiently for those beeps to finish, and I don't want to even think about. I believe I brute forced about 70% of the combinations for this device and never figured out the right answer. I don't know how I missed it if it started at 2851, this is the one puzzle that I had to have help with. And eventually I think my mom was like, why are you playing the same level over and over? And one of her coworkers had, their husband had a, the strategy guide and was able to give me like a subtle hint, like, can you step out of the elevator? And I was like, are you kidding me? And then I think I finished the game within a day or two after I got that hint, after having like been stuck for months. So that's my sad little story about the mechanical age. But with that, we've got all the pages. Or so you think. So what happens when we give Cirrus his last page?
Finally, sir.
Finally!
I owe you a debt of gratitude, for you have nearly released me.
Nearly?
My name is Cirrus. I trust that from your explorations you've become convinced that my wicked brother, Akhenar, is guilty, and I am innocent.
Well,
it is I who am wrongly imprisoned.
Pardon me.
Imprisoned by my father. I don't know who you are, or how you came to this island, but I assume you must at least know something of the books. It was father who was a master of the books. He wrote hundreds of them, all describing and linking to the fantastic places and ages which he had discovered. The room in which you now stand was our father's library. It was here in this room, on this island named Mist, that he housed most of these books. But such a waste. By now, you have surely discovered that Akhenar has burnt and mutilated most of these books. Why? Our father was always watchful of our exploration. We grew up under his strict supervision. But when we came of age, he gave us unbridled access to the Mist books. He began to leave our adventures more and more unchecked. Unsupervised
like
as we were, my brother began to become disturbed. He began to take more from the Mist ages than he had given. Soon he gained a twisted pleasure from the conquest and destruction of the other ages. It was horrific. His thirst for destruction. But alas, even I discovered his insanity too late. He had completely destroyed all of the Mist ages but four. I wasted no time. In warning my father, I thought he would recognize Akhenar's guilt. But in a fit of rage, he imprisoned both my brother and myself within the pages of these books, designed to hold us until he could judge which of us was guilty. To discover the truth, our father embarked on one final journey. However, he has never returned. I can only assume that he perished along the way.
Take only one page, my brother.
An innocent
man to
be trapped forever.
Well, as much as I want to keep listening to him, he tells you that you need to go in the fireplace and actually get the last page. The fireplace. What? How do you do that? Well, there's this secret book here that looks burned, but it actually has all these hundreds of combinations. And what in the world is this? Well, he tells you to go to page 158 and pull up a combination which allows you to get to what you're about to see. Now, I don't know if it works this way in the Miss Masterpiece Edition, or Real Mist Masterpiece Edition. But in the original game, if you put that combination in, come get a page here and give it to one of the books, it instantly counts as all of the pages, which is a neat little debug trick. So what's sitting up here is actually the linking book back to Earth, specifically Kavir, like an area of Dunny, an island, which is this lavish mansion and where Atrus is actually trapped because there was like a cave-in in the hallway or something and he can't leave. He can leave through his linking books to other worlds to sustain his life, but he can't come back to Mist. There's no linking book back to Mist. Or rather, he has the linking book back to Mist, but there's one page missing, so it doesn't work. So my dumb kid self opened this book and thought it was a linking book and clicked, ah, and jumped right to Dunny, and that's actually one of the ways to lose.
Who the devil are you? Don't come here to Dunny, not yet.
Oh. So I clicked the page immediately and warped to Dunny, and Atrus is like, well, I don't know who you are, but now we're both trapped here. And he's like super mad at you, and the game just kind of stalemates because you can't go back to Mist, but you can walk around Kavir and like not do anything. So instead, let's actually listen to what he has to say.
Who the devil are you? Don't come here to Dunny, not yet.
Oh, I think they re-recorded this. My friend. I don't know.
You no doubt have for me. Where should I begin? Perhaps my story is in order. My name is Atrus. I feel you've met my sons, Cirrus and Aghanar, in the red and blue books on Mist Island in my library. My library. It contains my works, my writings. Oh, I wrote many books that linked me to fantastic places. It's an art I learned from my father many years ago.
His father's name is Gil.
Oh, but the Red and Blue Books.
The main villain in Riven.
I wrote those books to entrap over greedy explorers who might stumble upon my island of mist. But I had no idea my own sons would be entrapped. My sons. Cirrus and Aghanar. We had many journeys together. I gave them free rein to the books. Perhaps it was not wise. I could see the greed growing in them. I had not told them about the red and blue books. Their imaginations went wild. They dreamed of riches and power. Of course, they did not know the books were traps. They begged me for access to those books, and I, of course, denied them. Oh, they devised a plan. An evil plan. I had no idea to what extent their greed had progressed. Their own mother. Oh, my own dear Catherine. They used her to lure me here to Dunny. Of course, I could return to Mist, except they removed a single page from my Mist linking book. I cannot return without that page. You, my friend, can bring that page to me.
So we have to find the final page of his linking book. I want to show you what the ending looks like, if we don't, because it's worth seeing. But needless to say, if you free either of the brothers, it's one of the bad ends, right? So you can trap yourself in Dunny, you can free the two brothers, so those are the three bad ends, and then the one good end is freeing Atrus. So let's get a save file going here. Okay, and drop the last page in. What's going to happen? Oh no, now I'm in the book. I hope I'm in the books.
Oh, yes!
Yes!
Yes! Oh! I'm free! Oh. Thank you, my friend. My dear friend. You've done the right thing. You stupid fool! It looks like perhaps you're in the book now.
Oh, man. The best scene.
And what have we here? A page.
Hope that didn't hurt.
Oh, no.
Ha 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 ha.
I hope you enjoy your new home as much as I enjoyed it.
I can't see you. You're getting less clear.
I hope you're into books.
Boy, let me tell you, one of my mom's favorite jokes. I can't tell you how many times over the years after we got this ending, she says, I hope you're into books. I mean, at least once a year for the last 2 decades. So he pulls all the pages out. Yeah, duh. I mean, you're trapped forever. I guess I can't even skip it.
Goodbye.
Let me out. What if I'm not really streaming from my room? What if I'm in a prison book too? Okay, so let's actually, like, not do that. Let's say. So remember, those two torn pages tell you to turn all the markers on, which we've done, as evidenced by the map. And then go back to the dock and turn it off. Oh! There you go. Somehow the red page disappeared, and now I have a white page, which is the last page of the linking book. So now we gotta go back in here, and I don't know if I have to redo the sequence or not. Okay. Come on. Did I miss one? Yes! Okay. 2 for 3, I bet. So let's jump in.
Have you found the missing page?
I thought there was a plane going away. It must have been the atmosphere music. So it's so weird. They modeled all this in 3D and it looks so cool and creepy and atmospheric, but man, the way they layered this real-time modeling underneath this, well, you'll see. It's a little uncanny valley.
Ah, my friend, you've returned. And the page, did you bring the page? Ah. Give it to me.
If you don't, he just keeps asking.
Give me the page.
It's very awkward.
Please.
Here, take it.
God. I've done the right thing.
That book, that big book he has, is the Riven book, which he's trying to work on.
I am
because it's falling apart, which you find out in the next game. But watch this. It's like magic. Magic gel fingers. He has a difficult choice to make. His sons have betrayed him. He knows what he has to do.
My sons have betrayed me. I know what I must do.
Yeah, you do.
I shall return shortly.
And I think you used, in like the original, you could just like walk around for a while. Like you just waited for him to go do something and then he'd come back. But I think this version just kind of locks you into place.
It is done.
Whatever you did, it was 20 seconds.
I have questions for you, my friend, but my rating cannot wait.
It's true.
I fear that my long delay may have already had a catastrophic impact on the world in which my wife Catherine is being held hostage.
It's such a great end to this game, because Riven didn't exist, there was no mythology about Riven, but they stuck this just absolute stinger at the end.
Reward. I'm sorry, but all I have to offer you is the library on the Island of Mist. The books that are contained there. Feel free to explore at your leisure. Your explorations are satisfying.
pretty satisfying, I will admit.
You will no longer have my sons to deal with.
I'm not sure what he did, but it looks like he pulled out a shotgun on him when you go back to the... I mean, there are just craters where these books used to be. But this is just the best ending. This little last bit they threw in.
Oh, and one more favor. I'm fighting a foe much greater than my sons could ever have imagined.
Spoilers, it's his father.
At some point in the future, I may find it necessary to request your assistance. Till that point, you're free to enjoy the exploration from my library on Myst. And thank you again.
So that's where the original game ends. But to entice people to buy a 3D real-time version of Myst.
Oh, the book. You can use the Myst linking book to return to Myst.
Well, I tried. You know, if you just settle down, Captain Sassy Pants. He left me a personal note that repeated what he said. How nice of him. I mean, seriously, what a guy. Yeah, now we get the creepy 3D version of Atris. Yikes. Yikes, yikes, yikes. Let's go back to Myst. Okay. We're not quite done, because they added a fifth age in Real Myst. There's this book on the floor that talks about rhyme. A very cold place that Atris is working with crystals and electricity and color, and you get this number, 2735. Okay, remember that, 2735. Okay. Whoa, what's that? Well, how did we get there? So, you actually have to go to the dimensional imager, which is beside at the very, very beginning of this game. We pulled that note that said enter the number of marker switches in. If you do that, you get this nice little message from Atris that kind of sends you on your way. It's the inciting incident for the player, right? I guess we can see that real quick. It's 8. You can only get to 7, but you can see the 8th. The other side of the gear bridge.
Catherine, my love, I have to leave quickly. Something terrible has happened. It's hard for me to believe. Most of my books have been destroyed.
I suspect Akinar.
Catherine is one of our sons. I suspect Akinar, but I shouldn't make conclusions. I'll find him and Cirrus as well.
Oh, I should. It's an odd device, you know, like you can only display like the entire fullness of your face, but
okay. Well, I've removed the remaining undamaged books from the library and placed them in their places of protection. You shouldn't have to use the books until I return, but if you've forgotten the access keys, remember the tower rotation. Oh, and don't worry, Catherine, everything will be fine. I'll see you shortly. Oh, and erase this message after you've viewed it, just to be safe.
So that's, oh, that's right, there's a flashlight in this game. Well, if you press F, you get a flashlight. What do you know? Okay. So what we actually can do is to get that topo map. I'm not sure if it's of the island or not. I think it's literally a test they did in whatever 3D program they used. The way they did the actual like 3D modeling of these islands is they did grayscale maps in Photoshop, literally Photoshop 1, and then used Stratovision 3D, something like that, to extrude them based on the grayscale value, and then did a painted texture map on top. Obviously, this is actual 3D modeling and not faux 3D back then. But whoa, what's that? You could never walk back here in the original, so that was a clever place to hide. And then you can see there's like the spaceship and the pillars you walk on, and you turn this around. Very, very clever how they extended the original world without really creating any any breaking changes that kind of invalidated the original. But just as you can walk down here to reset this switch if you need to, you go down here, and you put in that code, 2735, I think it was, and then this thing raises, and then that's that column you saw in the library. So now let's actually go back to Rhyme and see what it's all about. Almost done. I have some closing remarks after we see the little Easter egg at the end of Rhyme, and then we'll have wrapped up Myst. So, graphics are pretty cool. It's terrifyingly cold. It's basically Michigan. Not much to this. You can't open the door originally. You have to come out here, turn on this valve, so that when you go in this room, you can turn on the furnace. The game basically just lets you go right back to Myst, so that if you can't figure these out, it's like you're not trapped here. The furnace heats this room up and defrosts this door, which lets you into this hallway. There's some books in here you can read about with more mythology about the crystals, and it kind of ties into some of the lore from Riven. If you go up here, you can play with the electric controls, where you can, like... I know you can. You can create light displays and electric displays. Real, guys. You see this little secret button that only displays. The elevator can turn back and forth. You read this book, and you can get some information about some fill-in backstory, but we're not really interested in that. I'm actually really interested in it, but not on stream. And then finally, we end up in this final room, where you solve a small little crystal puzzle to see an image through this crystal that's been placed on a book. So let's go ahead and solve this puzzle real quick. I promise you, the solution is literally right down there in that page. So it's like just annoying enough that you have to keep going back and checking it every time if you don't quite have it right. I think that's right. And look at that. We see a picture of Riven. And the music changes, and you feel great because you've connected the two games explicitly now. So this is supposed to be a world that shows that Atrus is using technology and science and experimentation to figure out how he can affect and improve Riven. But that's kind of another story for another stream. So let's go to bed. Gonna walk out on this hallway. I think we're done with Myst. Okay. So that was Myst, and then the extra components from Real Myst, Astropiece. So I have some closing thoughts. When I beat this game originally, the way that Atrus wraps up the story and describes essentially, like, look, I need your help eventually for a sequel, essentially. The first thing my, like, 12 or 13-year-old brain did was pick up the phone, call EB Games, and say, when is Myst 2 coming out? Because of course it is, right? Like, I had no reason to believe, other than the story in the game, that this thing existed. And to my surprise, they said, oh, yeah, just a few months. I mean, you're almost time. I don't think they actually asked me to pre-order at the time. But, I was just blown away. I was like, wait, seriously? There really is a second one? Holy crap. And then I swear, I remember going to Arby's with my dad not a week or two after I beat this game. And they had some TVs in the seating area. And like CNN had like a stinger before commercial that showed what looked like a Myst game. And I was like, is that Myst 2? And sure enough, it was a sequence on, like, an upcoming game. I guess back then, you know, Myst had already taken the world by storm and had sold through a lot of its copies. And people were just like, if Myst 2 Riven, right, was almost out, then it must have been kind of a big deal if you had money and you were into this kind of thing. And they had a whole sequence on CNN for it. And I wonder, now that I'm thinking about it, if I could find that on YouTube or something, but I'll have to look. Anyway, it came out in October, but my parents wanted me to wait till Christmas. And so I remember seeing the big displays in the mall and the ball. I think it's on the cover. Yeah, this iconic graphic of the Moiety Age in Riven. The cardboard cutout in the mall, and I was just like, it was all my body could do to not just, spontaneously combust at the anticipation of playing this game. And, oh man, I still remember the morning we opened our gifts Christmas morning. As soon as we were done, I beelined it to the computer, stuck Riven in, got things going, and just, boy, what an experience. Myst set me down this path, and it ranks up there in my favorite games of all time. But man, Riven has got to be right up there in the top five, top three somewhere. What a special game, and that's for next time, right? So this book, The Book of Atrus, actually came out before Riven, and I want to say I read it before Riven. Feels like there's not a ton of time in my recollection for like having acquired and read this book, but we did go on vacation a lot in an RV, and I did read a ton back then, and my parents really encouraged that. And so it doesn't strike me as too odd that I would have done that. But the book actually revolves quite a bit around the setup for Myst, and involves quite a bit of backstory about Atrus and his wife and his father, and sort of why there's all this connection to Riven, and sort of actually does set up the backstory for Riven a couple years before the game even released. And I remember getting toward that section knowing that Riven was out or about to be out, and worrying that there were going to be spoilers in it. But honestly, I think I don't know if it's required reading, but it definitely, definitely improved my enjoyment and understanding of the story in Riven, which is quite a bit more complex than the kind of simple story in Myst. Random tidbit that is still, even as I looked up stories for it today and prep for this, still almost like impossible to believe. Disney World in Orlando. I live in Orlando right now. And I've gone to Disney World a number of times in my life. There's an island. So there's an old, there's a big lake off the Magic Kingdom called Bay Lake, and the Wilderness Lodge is on that lake, and the Fort Wilderness Campground is on that lake, and the Contemporary Resort is on that lake, and there's a monorail that kind of connects the Contemporary and the Magic Kingdom. And anyway, there's this lake, and you can ride a boat from these resorts, and it's kind of a nice thing. I still do it at least a couple times a year. But there's an island in the middle of this lake. Discovery Island, that used to be a park that you could go to, and I'm pretty sure I did as a kid. I don't remember much about it, but the boats would take you from these resorts to the dock, and you'd get off and pay like a small fee, and it was kind of like a zoo. They had walking paths and cages and bird nets, and I mean, your typical kind of zoo experience. Apparently, Disney got quite a bit down into talks and plans to work with the creators of Myst to develop that space after it had kind of shut down. I mean, the original park at Discovery Island did close down when I was pretty young. They were going to repurpose this space as a Myst, like, themed area, because all of the trappings of Myst were already there, right? Like, you had the isolated island and the walkways and the infrastructure and everything already there. If I read the article correctly, I believe that Disney even helped them kind of push out these novels just so that there'd be sort of more of a cultural awareness of the story and the mythos and everything. And then it just fell through, and they never did anything with it. And that's just absolutely crazy to me. I don't know what my young brain would have done if I knew there was a Myst theme park less than 3 hours from where I lived, at a place just off of the campground that I've camped at. many times. I don't know. It's just unreal that that was even a thing. Apparently, Hulu also bought rights to develop a Myst TV series just a couple years ago, and apparently that is still in the works, even though there's no like concrete anything out there. It may never happen, but it's apparently still in progress. Yeah, so this game, you know, I love Riven. Riven's the one I always think of. Myst is definitely the piece of that puzzle that was required to get me to Riven. So anytime I introduce friends or family or whatever to this series, you have to start with Myst. I mean, it's definitely the on-ramp to Riven, and it's still like a great game in its own regard. And as an adult, you should be able to sit down and trudge through this game pretty quickly. None of the puzzles are too complex, and you can brute force most of them. But, you know, over the years, I've been able to introduce people in my life to it and watch them play it, and that's always just awesome. And I mean, it was as awesome as it was 10 years ago as introducing, you know, some friends to it, even as recently as a year or so ago. So despite having spoiled everything, I still encourage you to play it, buy it, tell your friends about it. It's still a treasure, and with all the rich history behind it, even more so. The soundtracks are fantastic for both Myst and Riven. Myst 3 and 4's soundtrack was actually done by Jack Wall, who went on to do the Mass Effect soundtracks. So as we get into those games, those soundtracks just get even better. And I think all of them are available on Spotify and Apple Music. So thanks for watching. I had a blast putting this together and kind of trying to take this seriously and do some research about my favorite series and collect my thoughts on sort of the experiences I've had with it over the years. But I did come across a quote from an interview with AV Club from the creators on sort of what it was like to be part of a small game that blossomed into the best-selling game of the 20th century. And I want to just read that quote really quickly because I think it applies to a lot beyond the game and life in general. The interviewer asked, if you could go back 23, 24 years and tell yourself one thing while you were making Myst, what would it be? And they answered, oh my gosh, okay, honestly, this is some deep stuff, but I'm older now, and a lot of what happened with Myst, I now realize a lot of it, a majority of it, just had to do with luck, and I think that's how the world works. I think a lot of people work very hard, and they don't get lucky. I think I would have told myself, don't confuse luck with any sort of elevated view of yourself. You were in the right place at the right time, and you did a lot of hard work, but a lot of people do hard work. It worked for you, be grateful, and don't think too much of yourself. And what a great attitude to have after having been so successful, and I wish more successful people had that kind of attitude. So there you have it. Myst everywhere. Myst. The prep for Riven might take a while. Riven is a much longer game, a much more complex set of puzzles. I'm going to have to come up with like a critical path to move through that game to be able to explain everything that's going on and also be interesting and not boring. So, you know, until next time, I'll have to find a version of Riven that works. Oh man, I hope there is one, because it runs a lot like the old Myst that I couldn't get running at all. So I guess worst comes to worst, we can stream the original PlayStation version and just trudge through that. So anyway, thanks for watching. I had a blast. Until next time, this is Raticoon from Twitch signing off.